What I'm going to try to do today is focus a lot on what we call know as the ENAM just bring some insights from the field studies we've done in Karnataka. So agriculture, as we all know, is a state subject. And if you look at the constitution, market is also a state subject. At the same time, the government of India has a larger responsibility of ensuring that the country has an integrated, there are no barriers within the nation on trading. So here you have some a dual responsibility of the state and the center, and that sort of frames the agricultural market environment. So at the center, we know the Essential Commodities Act, trade policy, the procurement and price policy is largely set by the center, although with the last one, states do have some role in the procurement, and we heard about the MSP bonuses yesterday in the context of FCI. I'm going to focus on the state level, which is the Agriculture Produce Marketing Regulations, and we call it APMC Acts, we'll stick to that, which came up in the 60s and 70s at different points of time, different states adopted it. I think the crux of the APMC is that post-independence, there was a need to actually regulate these markets to protect farmers' interests. So it was very much a farmer-centric legislation aimed to ensure that farmers were not left at the mercy of traders. So if anything that is visible is regulatable, and in that sense there was designated commodities which are called notified commodities, and market areas were defined, and each market area came under an APMC, and you can have mandis, sub mandis. I won't go into that in too much detail. Essentially, trade took place there, and there was a market fee paid to the which would go into the APMC, and it was meant to be plowed back to provide infrastructure. And traders and agents need to have a license to operate in a mandi. So this is the essential sort of elements of the APMC, but the way in which it took shape in different states are quite diverse. I won't go into that, but one example is even the notified commodities are very different across different states. So it can differ from something as basic as that. So the types of markets, I'll just skip over this, but just to say that the APMC regulated mandis are not the only mandis that are there. There are a lot of small markets that are regulated by the panchayats. So only 15% of periodic markets are regulated. So this is to suggest that the APMC is not the only kind of market space available, not even the only kind that's regulated, but it's definitely an important space. And I pulled this out from the National Sample Survey Situation Assessment of Farmers, and you see for different crops, the blue is actually the one that's sold in the mandi, and the red is actually to private traders. So depending on which crop you're looking at, the where you sell can be very, very different. So you're talking about a lot of heterogeneity and diversity, which is something that we have to keep in mind whenever we talk about markets, which is a general concept. So trade in the mandi, the key actors are commission agents and then the traders. Again, it varies by state. Madhya Pradesh, for example, doesn't have these agents at all by law. And there are the workers who are the hamalis. The farmers and the purchasers are, of course, at the tail end. So there are a lot of actors in a mandi, and so in terms of welfare consequences, it's important to know what happens to different players when things change in markets. And there are two broad modes of sale. One is an auction, which is like open cry auction so far, where there's a base price, and from there people bid for a particular lot, and the highest bidder wins. And there's a closed tender where people examine the produce and then write in their bid, and then they compare all the bids and the winner is declared. So these are the two ways in which price is determined in a market. It's easy to see what the traders can or cannot do in this context. One of the things that has historically been documented is that traders often end up colluding, so that the bid price and what they bid is actually pre-decided, and leaving the farmer quite clueless. And it's especially egregious in horticulture crops, where the farmer is often a bystander and the trader and the commission agent are actually negotiating on behalf of the farmer. But the essential marketing problem, so when you talk about reform, we had the system which was designed to be in the interests of the farmers, but over time it turned out that it wasn't working all that well, where farmers were actually at the receiving end and they didn't really have a say in the prices. And one of it comes from the essential problem of designing markets. So there are two dimensions I would specify. One is, how do you have the farmers access markets at the least cost? So you want proximity. On the other hand, you also want to ensure competitive markets. That is, the market should not be so thin that there are so few buyers that they can actually collude. So you want transparent price discovery. You want price signals to be formed reliably. So you have this thing about proximity versus thinness. Now imagine you take a market very close to the farmer. So supposing I have a village level APMC regulated mandi, there are going to be too few people. So collusion is easier. Whereas if I put one regulated market per state, you're going to have a lot more players making collusion hard. So there's an inbuilt trade-off between having small markets very accessible to farmers versus having markets that are competitive. And this is the essential problem that became a sort of a problem with many of the APMCs, because the original idea was to make things accessible, but then you traded off competitiveness. And then, of course, you want farmers to have choice of buyers and not to be pushed into mandis because the law says so. And then you also cared about a larger ecosystem. What if, for example, the farmers got prices they did not want? Can they store it? Can they hold out? Do they have the financial capacity to do so? Do they have the infrastructure to do so? So all of these also become the ecosystem of marketing. Unfortunately, under the old APMC, we accomplished neither. So how did we do? In terms of density of regulated markets, which is proximity, we weren't doing so well. So the National Commission on Farmers had recommended a radius of 5 kilometers. So essentially saying that every 80 square kilometers must have a market. But if you look at the range, even Punjab, which had the densest market network, had only one per 119 square kilometers. And Meghalaya, you can imagine the kind of difficulties in terms of terrain. It was very poorly served. So even on the dimension of proximity, we haven't really done a good job of making it easy for farmers to access markets. But we haven't done well with the other side also. The spot markets were not thick enough. There were not enough buyers and players, partly because to trade in each mandi, you need a license. So imagine a trader, if he or she wants to procure from different mandis, they have to get a number of licenses to trade in each. They need the manpower or agents on the ground to actually be able to execute these. So the costs of barriers to entry are quite large for the traders. So invariably you had these small markets where there was a lot of collusion. And I've just put this that consequently you have a lot of non-transparent price discovery. The price dispersion is quite large. And then, of course, you had the interstate barriers because each state had a different kind of APMC. So this is a list of the committees. And I just want to focus on the last one. So in the National Agriculture Policy in the early 2000s said, let's have a rainbow revolution. And they started making space for private players. And a lot of states actually adapted their laws to enable that. But I'm going to focus on the last one, which is on ENAM. And this idea that let's have an electronic national agriculture market. So what does the ENAM do? And I'm going to just focus on the principles of ENAM. And to enable ENAM, you need all the states to align their laws to enable a nationwide market. And they sort of produced an APLM model act, which they said if all states adopt that, then you can have a market. But if even one state doesn't adopt it, your market cannot yet be national. So in some sense, there's a lowest common denominator problem that the most restrictive state will actually determine how effectively the market is integrated. Now, the national agriculture market actually was based off what Karnataka began doing in early 2007, actually. And then in 2013, they had an act that actually enabled this to happen. Now, there are two elements to unified markets. One is a national market. One is unification and one is online trading, and both go hand in hand. So what happens is now, instead of getting a mandi-specific license, you're saying I'm going to get one license to be trade that I can use in any mandi. I don't need a mandi-specific license. So for the trader, you're decreasing the cost of buying in a market that can be very distant from him or her. Then you want to sort of, if I'm sitting in place A and I'm trying to bid in place B, how do I do it without having people on the ground? So the e-trading enables that. So I sort of bid on produce that's in place B while sitting at a computer in place A. So that's the online bidding and auction. Now, how do I do it? I have to have an assaying system because I have to know what I'm bidding for. So the idea is that the good comes in, it's assayed, it's graded, so that the better grade has a higher bid price, and so price is related to quality. And once I know that there is, it's assayed and it's this grade, I trust that assaying because it's done by the mandi, and I put my bid. And now what happens, all the bids come in from different locations, it's no longer local. To that extent, it increases the contestability of markets, and I may get a better price because now more participants are there. And now the winning bid is not manually done. It's processed by the computer. So the chances of favoritism, nepotism isn't there. And then the winning bid is declared, and the payments are cleared centrally and electronically so that the farmer gets the money into the bank account. And the receipt is generated, and because the receipt is now, the market is unified, you're not taxed at multiple points. So this is supposed to be the thing. And the two key things are unification, one license that works everywhere, and e-trading. So here you see the lots set, and people as of now physically inspect the quality, then go to the computers and they are bidding on the computer. And then the computer sort of declares the winner, and the winners are being announced. So this is a semi-automated system because assaying is still not being done here. Now we went to, because ENAM is modeled on the Karnataka model, we went to Karnataka to 10 mandis to see how it's working. It's published in the EPW as a paper, but I'm just going to sort of come to the findings. So in theory, the ENAM is a very good design. It's intended both to get proximity of markets because I can go to the nearest mandi and still have buyers who are from elsewhere. And I have this idea that it's unified and there is e-trading. So you have proximity and contestability, both of them being achieved in terms of design. But what we found was that not all elements were in place everywhere and for different reasons. And some of these I'll talk about. So only selected commodities were traded on the e-platform, and the decision was based on the total arrivals in the mandi. So for example, when there are very small quantities that come, everyone knows, there are so few buyers, everyone knows each other. So they end up saying, let's do a manual auction. We won't go to the computer to have online auctions. And e-trading, so because the trader lobby was quite resistant to many of the changes, e-trading, they ended up conducting only selected days of the week. So, and the reason that the mandi officials told us was that the arrivals don't come steadily each day. So when the days when they actually come, there are days when nothing comes. So in the season when something comes, then we do e-trading. If there are too few, then we do manual. So there's no consistent system, and it's a day-to-day decision that they seem to take. And several commission agents we found were also registered as traders, suggesting that, you know, this idea that traders are bidding from elsewhere. So essentially what traders ended up doing was getting commission agents to register as traders and trade on their behalf. So what was an old system was just modified to a new framework. We also found that, of course, all of us know that there's a very strong relationship between farmers and commission agents and the commission agents and traders. And I'll elaborate on that point a little in the next slides. And the assaying instruments seem to be a big problem because assaying takes time, and very small farmers don't want to part with samples because it's a loss for them. And to get it assayed, it takes time, and they when the arrivals are peak and pigeon pea tour and all of that, you just can't assay every lot. So the assaying is somewhat it's inadequate, and they are mostly unutilized. So what we found was between e-trading and unification, e-trading had some benefits. Okay, it saves a lot of time because bids were now declared. Manually matching 10,000 bids used to take a long time. So now the computer does process it and gets it out. So it's only a few seconds, whereas before it used to be several hours. So the farmers say it's safer for us to take the money, travel out, and it's all done. So in some ways, they don't have to wait till night time to get the money and go home. They also said there is a reduction of possibility of mistakes or manipulation. Many times the bids used to retrospectively be adjusted so that your favorite person won the bid. Now it's not possible because the computer sort of does it automatically. So the system is more transparent. But there's always a claim that once the ENAM comes and farmers get a better price, the arrivals in the mandi will increase. Most people said that's not happened at all. And some specific issues that came up was in perishables like jaggery. They said that when you have an online auction or a bid, only the best quality gets traded. Whereas when you do it manually, there's negotiation on the price and all qualities find a buyer. So this was one of the issues. And then the infrastructure problems are huge. So they said the power cuts, internet connectivity, server issues, they just doesn't make online trading feasible at all. I want to just focus on the Tiptur issue. This is a very big market where you would think that this system would work very well. But there was a trader called Rudraya who essentially they used to have a meeting. About 100 traders would meet at his house and they would all decide to put the same bid, just plus or minus 2 rupees. So even though this was supposed to not have collusion, because the collusion breaks when there are traders from outside the mandi. But here, there were no outsiders because they were not bidding because they didn't know the quality and assaying was not done. And so collusion was happening anyway. And so in some sense, it didn't solve the problem that it was supposed to solve. On unification, the central problem is really quality. A trader outside, who does he or she trust? They do not trust the assaying by the APMC. They also feel that there are parameters that cannot be assayed. So for example, in jaggery, it's luminosity and translucence. So they put it against the light to check if it's good quality. So they say these are not the parameters that are ever tested. So in some sense, assaying as a way of expanding markets doesn't seem to happen, and the traders seem to prefer having their own person on the ground. The logistics issue, okay, supposing I'm a trader building from outside, who takes care of the shipping and the delivery, right? There's no clarity on that. And so far, actually, the commission agents were doing all of that. They were taking on the role of managing the entire transaction and being compensated for in different ways by both the farmer and trader. That doesn't happen. So I've already talked about assaying. And one of the things that came very clear is in the government, there was a lot of discussion on making assaying mandatory. But there is complete there's lack of disagreement. So everyone agrees that if you actually make it mandatory, you're just going to drive trade out of the mandis. The final bit is actually with e-payments. So one of the interesting features in ENAM was that I get paid electronically. But many of us who are aware of the extent of financial inclusion and access to banking know that this is a bit difficult. So for farmers, they say access to banking services is a challenge. And the other problem they have is you pay into our loan accounts and they remove that money for repayment of loans. And we don't have control over the money we earn. So they said that we do not want payments into a bank account that is linked to our loan account. Yeah, you can imagine why they would want that. Traders say that we are not going to clear the bills immediately because I need to come receive the product and be assured that the quality they said it was is actually true. And so I'm not going to pay until I get that. So in some sense, the traders are unwilling to put in the money via e-payment. The commission agents actually are the ones who suffer. One of the commission agents said all commission agents are like now in the ICU. Because they are squeezed. I think we sometimes underappreciate the role of the commission agents. Because when the farmer comes, they are providing storage services. Then they actually mediate the transaction. And they are the ones who are actually involved in the logistics and sometimes also in credit to the farmers. So in such a scenario, I think unless we think of the commission agent's role, they are not indispensable. They are actually performing such a critical role, and there's no way in which an ENAM can function by removing them from the picture. So these are the issues. And so I just to summarize, the major challenges with the national unified market is an assaying issue. Unless you know what you're buying for, I'm never going to bid on anything that I can't see. It needs to be quick and cheap. Access to credit has to be there for farmers and traders, and I would add commission agents as well. The mandi infrastructure needs to be in place. And the payment channel, we have to innovate at that end as well, where it doesn't always have to go through the banks. The closest we came to where commission agents are irrelevant are through cooperatives for collective marketing, because a cooperative now supplies all of the services that commission agents actually were providing. And this is for Shimoga and Arakanat. You go and see that system, you say, okay, this is how it's supposed to be, where farmers get they have the right to refuse the low price, and the cooperative has storage facilities. So you have a very nice system where farmers can hold out and they get a loan, for a pledge loan against the produce. So it's a nice system, and anyone who wants to see how you can organize it, I think the Shimoga Arakanat is a very good example. So I'm just wrapping up. So the status of ENAM, as of yesterday I checked, there are 429 markets in 18 states. When we checked, the online trading was very notional, one crop per mandi on a few days. And we saw in Haryana, actually, they did everything as before. And at the end of the day, they used to enter it in the portal. So it's ENAM data entry.